Categories of angels. Number 1. Ordinary angels. Whether you have ever served in the armed forces or not, I am sure you know how the military classifies its recruits. In the Army, for example, we have generals at the top, and then down through colonels, majors, captains, and lieutenants. And enlisted men also may be recognized by various ranks and functions. Are you aware that God also categorizes angels? Our God is an orderly God. The heavenly host, in a general sense, probably the largest group of angels, is what we might call ordinary angels. Most of the time when angels are mentioned in the Bible, it is these otherwise unidentified angels who are being referred to. To speak of ordinary angels, however, seems to be a contradiction in itself. For how can one regard these extraordinary, amazing, unique, specially created beings as routine? But in a sense, this designation is appropriate when we contrast it with the various special orders of angels to which the Bible refers. Number 2. Cherubim. The cherubim are a group of celestial beings created by God. They are the first of the angelic hierarchy to appear in the Bible, immediately following Adam and Eve's fall from grace. Genesis 3 records the events in the Garden of Eden. Having violated God's commandment not to partake of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, it would have been likely for Adam and Eve to reach out their hands and take also of the tree of life, and eat and live forever. As a result, they were forced to leave their earthly paradise. But what would have stopped Adam from going back to the garden and disobeying God again? The answer is given in this verse. Genesis chapter 3, verse 24. So he drove the man out, and at the east of the Garden of Eden, he stationed the cherubim and the flaming sword, which turned every direction to guard the way to the tree of life. What a terrible situation it would have been if Adam had eaten of the tree of life, and so have been perpetually established in his fallen state. God sent a contingent of glorious and trusted cherubim to guard access to the tree to prevent that. We don't know Adam's reaction to witnessing those glorious cherubim for the first time in human history. Perhaps awe, fright, and wonder are all emotions that come to mind. Adam realized that his transgression had cut him off from the company and presence of a holy God. Oddly enough, the next occurrence of the cherubim in the Bible involves recovering what was lost. Moses. In Exodus 25, Moses was given specific and detailed instructions on how to make several articles of furniture that would be used in the tabernacle. The Ark of the Covenant and the Mercy Seat, where God promised to meet and commune with Moses, were the first to be detailed. What did God want to go over or on top of the mercy seat? He chose representations of the cherubim in gold. The following is God's intriguing description to Moses. Exodus chapter 25, verses 10 through 13. Now they shall construct an ark of acacia wood 2.5 cubits long, 1.5 cubits wide, and 1.5 cubits high. You shall overlay it with pure gold. Inside and out you shall overlay it. You shall make a gold molding around it. You shall also cast 4 gold rings for it, and fasten them on its 4 feet. 2 rings shall be on one side of it, and 2 rings on the other side of it. And you shall make poles of acacia wood, and overlay them with gold. What an awesome sight that must have been! The cherubim associated with the very presence of God. From those two sources in the Bible, it appears as though the cherubim's major responsibility may be to declare man's sinfulness and protect the presence of God from sinful men. As much as Adam yearned to return to the Garden of Eden, the cherubim reminded him that he had broken God's law. The high priest of Israel would be allowed into the Holy of Holies once a year to gaze upon the mercy seat. I'm sure he must have felt on each occasion, "I don't belong here in the holy presence of God, for I am a sinner." Cherubim are real and powerful beings. However, the cherubim in the Bible were often representative of heavenly things. They were integrated into the design of the Ark of the Covenant and the tabernacle at God's command. Ezekiel chapter 10, verses 8 through 14. The cherubim appeared to have something like a human hand under their wings. Then I looked, and behold, four wheels beside the cherubim, one wheel beside each cherub, and the appearance of the wheels was like the gleam of a Tarshish stone. And as for their appearance, all four of them had the same likeness, as if one wheel were within another wheel. When they moved, they went in any of their four directions without turning as they went. But they followed in the direction which they faced, without turning as they went. And their whole body, their backs, their hands, their wings, and the wheels were covered with eyes all around, the wheels belonging to all four of them. The wheels were called, as I heard, the whirling wheels, and each one had four faces. The first face was the face of a cherub. The second face was the face of a human. The third, the face of a lion. And the fourth, the face of an eagle. The cherubim are shown in Ezekiel 10 as having not only wings and hands, but also being full of eyes, encompassed by wheels within wheels. However, Ezekiel also paints a gloomy tone in chapter 10, and the cherubim provide the hint. The prophet presents his vision that prophesies the destruction of Jerusalem. In Ezekiel chapter 9, verse 3, the Lord has descended from his throne above the cherubim to the threshold of the temple, while in chapter 10, verse 1, he returns again to take his seat above them. In the calm before the storm, we see the cherubim stationed on the south side of the sanctuary. Being stationed in position toward the city, they witness the beginning of the gradual withdrawal of God's glory from Jerusalem. The fluttering of their wings indicates immensely important events to follow. Chapter 10, verse 5. Then the cherubim rise up in preparation for the departure. While Ezekiel 10 is difficult to understand, one point comes across clearly. The cherubim are associated with God's splendor. This chapter is one of the Bible's most cryptic and yet evocative passages about God's grandeur, and it involves angelic beings. It should be read with care and prayer. Few other chapters in the Bible give the reader a feeling of God's greatness and glory. Seraphim. Another group of specially identified angels are the seraphim. In the Hebrew language, seraphim means burning ones. The book of Isaiah tells us of the seraphim. In the later half of Israel's kingdom period, Isaiah lived in Jerusalem and spoke on God's behalf to the leaders of Jerusalem and Judah. He expressed, first of all, a message of God's judgment. He admonished Israel's corrupt leaders that their rebellion against their covenant with God would come at a cost, that God was going to use the great empires of Assyria, and after them Babylon, to judge Jerusalem if they continued in idolatry and tyranny of the poor. But that declaration was incorporated with a message of hope. Isaiah's grand vision of God sitting on his throne in the temple, surrounded by heavenly creatures shouting, "God is holy, holy, holy," And Isaiah suddenly sees how corrupt he and his people Israel are. And he thinks he'll be destroyed by God's holiness, but he isn't. Then, one of the seraphim flew and burns him, but not to destroy, but rather to purify him from his sin. And as Isaiah mulls over this peculiar experience, God assigns him a tough task. He is to keep preaching the coming judgment, but because Israel has reached a point of no return, his warnings will paradoxically harden the people. So the hardening impact of the Word of God is a key theme. And it is no wonder that Isaiah asked, "How long do I have to go on preaching and hardening them with no response?" Isaiah had one of the toughest assignments of all the prophets. But of course, if he hadn't gone through with it, we wouldn't have this amazing book. He didn't know that centuries ahead, this book would be an inspiration. But in his lifetime, he was a failure. Nobody listened. They just got harder and harder for 40 years. "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with 6 wings. With 2 wings they covered their faces, with 2 they covered their feet, and with 2 they were flying. And they were calling to one another, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory.' At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and threshold shook, and the temple was filled with smoke." Despite the fact that the seraphim and cherubim belong to different hierarchies and are shrouded in mystery in the Bible, they share one trait. They are continuously praising God. Angels and celestial beings are lovely, but they pale in contrast to our heavenly Lamb, the Lord of glory, before whom all forces in heaven and on earth bow in holy devotion and breathless adoration. In his vision depicted in Isaiah 6, Isaiah witnessed personally God's holiness. Isaiah, while being a prophet of God and a blameless man, was aware of his own sinfulness. Even the seraphim in God's presence, those who were crying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty," covered their faces and feet with 4 of their 6 wings. Covering the face and feet no doubt expresses the reverence and awe caused by the direct presence of God. In Revelation 4, John had a vision of God's throne that was identical to Isaiah's. In reverence and amazement of the Holy One, living things surrounded the throne, crying out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Revelation chapter 4, verse 8. The creatures around God's throne, according to John, are constantly paying praise, honor, and reverence to him. Finally, the angels around the throne in both visions scream out, "Holy, holy, holy," indicating that God is the same in both testaments. We often think of the Old Testament God as a God of anger, and the New Testament God as a God of love. Isaiah and John, on the other hand, paint a united picture of our holy, magnificent, and glorious God, who does not change. Malachi chapter 3, verse 6, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, and with whom is no variableness nor shadow of turning. James chapter 1, verse 17. God's holiness is eternal, just as he is eternal. Because Isaiah mentions each one and one cried unto another, we can presume there were several seraphim. The seraphim's job is to sing praises to God's name and character in heaven. Their ministry relates directly to God and his heavenly throne, because they are positioned above the throne, unlike the cherubim who are beside it. They were indescribably beautiful. With two wings he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he did fly, implying that some angelic beings fly. The Bible does not, however, support the common notion that all angels have wings. The conventional concept of angels with wings is drawn from their ability to move instantaneously and with unlimited speed from place to place, and wings were thought to permit such limitless movement. Holy Ones and Watchers. The Holy Ones and Watchers are portrayed in the Book of Daniel, which is set in Babylon. The story starts shortly after Babylon's first attack on Jerusalem, and they had plundered the city and its temple, and taken a wave of Israelites into exile. Four members of David's royal family were among them. Daniel, afterwards known as Belteshazzar, and his three companions. The Book of Daniel takes place in Babylon, a nation governed by Nebuchadnezzar, a pompous and ruthless ruler who delighted in torturing his subjects. He conquered Assyria and then set his sights on Egypt, his main rival. Judah was in the way. Thus it had to go if his aim of leading a vast empire was to be realized. Nebuchadnezzar's life-changing experience began with another troubling dream. The king informed his magicians, mediums, Chaldeans, and diviners, but they were unable to decipher it. The king sent for Daniel after everyone else had failed. Given Daniel's previous experience with dreams, it's odd that Nebuchadnezzar queried his wise men instead of going straight to Daniel. You see, Daniel had interpreted a dream previously regarding a large statue, an enormous dazzling statue, awesome in appearance. The head of the statue was made of pure gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of baked clay. Daniel chapter 2 verse 36. This was the dream, and now we will interpret it to the king. This was different. Nebuchadnezzar's dream had a promising start. He saw a tree grow tall and powerful, and it was so fruitful that it provided for every kind of creature. But soon, the dream became bleak. I, Nebuchadnezzar, was at ease in my house and flourishing in my palace. I had a dream, and it frightened me. While in my bed, the images and visions in my mind alarmed me. So I issued a decree that all the wise men of Babylon be brought before me to interpret the dream for me. In these visions of my mind as I was lying in bed, I saw this come to pass. There was a tree in the midst of the land, and its height was great. The tree grew large and strong. Its top reached the sky, and it was visible to the ends of the earth. Its leaves were beautiful, its fruit was abundant, and upon it was food for all. Under it, the beasts of the field found shelter. In its branches the birds of the air nested, and from it every creature was fed. As I lay on my bed, I also saw in the visions of my mind a watcher, a holy one coming down from heaven. He called out in a loud voice, "Cut down the tree and chop off its branches. Strip off its leaves and scatter its fruit. Let the beasts flee from under it, and the birds from its branches. But leave the stump with its roots in the ground, and a band of iron and bronze around it, in the tender grass of the field. Let him be drenched with the dew of heaven, and graze with the beasts on the grass of the earth. Let his mind be changed from that of a man, and let him be given the mind of a beast till 7 times pass him by. This decision is the decree of the watchers, the verdict declared by the holy ones, so that the living will know that the Most High rules over the kingdom of mankind and gives it to whom he wishes, setting over it the lowliest of men. This is the dream that I, King Nebuchadnezzar, saw. Now Belteshazzar, tell me the interpretation, because none of the wise men of my kingdom can interpret it for me. But you are able, because the spirit of the holy gods is in you. For a time, Daniel, who was also known as Belteshazzar, was perplexed, and his thoughts alarmed him. So the king said, Belteshazzar, do not let the dream or its interpretation alarm you. My lord, replied Belteshazzar, may the dream apply to those who hate you, and its interpretation to your enemies. The tree you saw that grew large and strong, whose top reached the sky and was visible to all the earth, whose foliage was beautiful, and whose fruit was abundant, providing food for all, under which the beasts of the field lived, and in whose branches the birds of the air nested. You, O king, are that tree, for you have become great and strong. Your greatness has grown to reach the sky, and your dominion extends to the ends of the earth. And you, O king, saw a watcher, a holy one, coming down from heaven and saying, cut down the tree and destroy it, but leave the stump with its roots in the ground, and a band of iron and bronze around it, in the tender grass of the field. Let him be drenched with the dew of heaven, and graze with the beasts of the field till 7 times pass him by. This is the interpretation, O king, and this is the decree that the Most High has issued against my lord the king. You will be driven away from mankind, and your dwelling will be with the beasts of the field. You will feed on grass like an ox, and be drenched with the dew of heaven. And 7 times shall pass you by, until you acknowledge that the Most High rules over the kingdom of mankind, and gives it to whom he wishes. As for the command to leave the stump of the tree with its roots, your kingdom will be restored to you as soon as you acknowledge that heaven rules. Therefore, may my advice be pleasing to you, O king. Break away from your sins by doing what is right, and from your iniquities by showing mercy to the oppressed. Perhaps there will be an extension of your prosperity. All this happened to King Nebuchadnezzar. 12 months later, as he was walking on the roof of the royal palace of Babylon, the king exclaimed, is this not Babylon the Great, which I myself have built by the might of my power, as a royal residence and for the glory of my majesty? While the words were still in the king's mouth, a voice came from heaven. It is decreed to you, King Nebuchadnezzar, that the kingdom has departed from you. You will be driven away from mankind to live with the beasts of the field, and you will feed on grass like an ox. And 7 times will pass you by, until you acknowledge that the Most High rules over the kingdom of mankind, and gives it to whom he wishes. Daniel chapter 4, verses 10 through 32. A holy one gave the order to cut down the tree and strip it bare, leaving nothing but a stump. Then, the stump was to have a band of iron and bronze around it. Let him be drenched with dew suggests the tree was actually a man. He was to be driven mad and given the mind of an animal for 7 years. What was the purpose of this decree? So that the living will know that the Most High is a ruler over human kingdoms. God apparently revealed to Daniel what the dream meant as soon as Nebuchadnezzar had finished telling it, because the interpretation left Daniel stunned for a moment. He didn't wish ill for the king. He wanted to see him come to repentance before God and forestall this awful judgment against the king. Daniel gave the king the good news, followed by the bad. Nebuchadnezzar was not only the tree, but would also be the stump. The last word in Daniel's visit was his heartfelt plea for Nebuchadnezzar to repent and throw himself on the mercy of God. But interestingly, there was no response from the king at all. Repentance had worked for King Ahab after he slew a man for his property. After warning from Elijah, God postponed the fall of his kingdom, that he would not see it happen till after his death. He behaved in the vilest manner by going after idols, like the Amorites, the Lord drove out before Israel. When Ahab heard these words, he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth, and fasted. He lay in sackcloth and went around meekly. Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite. Have you noticed how Ahab has humbled himself before me? Because he has humbled himself, I will not bring this disaster in his day, but I will bring it on his house in the days of his son. 1 Kings chapter 21 verses 25 through 27. Nebuchadnezzar failed to do so. And Nebuchadnezzar seemed to have forgotten God's warning about his arrogance. God's 12-month extension of grace had no effect on the king's decision to repent. If anything, the delay helped him believe he had gotten away with it. Is this not Babylon the Great that I have built? By my vast power and for my majestic glory? In other words, he had reached the pinnacle of his pride and was congratulating himself on the beauty of the empire he had constructed. But just then, a voice from heaven spoke, announcing the judgment Nebuchadnezzar had seen predicted in his dream. He was immediately seized by a type of madness that caused him to act and live like an animal. Nebuchadnezzar made a declaration that was considerably different from his earlier one, once his long punishment had ended. He extolled the Most High, saying, "He praised the Most High, saying his dominion is an everlasting dominion. He does what he wants. No one can block his hand." There are several things we can learn from the Watchers and the Holy Ones. First, they are God's agent in judgment. He called in a loud voice, "Cut down the tree and trim off its branches. Strip off its leaves and scatter its fruit." The decision is announced by messengers. The Holy Ones declare the verdict, so that the living may know that the Most High is sovereign over all kingdoms on earth, and gives them to anyone he wishes, and sets over them the lowliest of people. Daniel chapter 4, verses 14 through 17. According to the Bible, angels have worked throughout history to carry out judgments, directing the fates of nations who have disobeyed God. For example, God used angels in scattering the people of Israel because of their sins. He also used angels to punish Sodom and Gomorrah, as well as Babylon and Nineveh in the end. Angels will also administer judgment on individuals who have rejected God's love at the end of the era. Angelic forces are described as executors of God's judgments by the writer of Hebrews, "who maketh his angels spirits, and his ministers a flame of fire." Hebrews chapter 1, verse 7. Angels administer judgment in accord with God's principles of righteousness. The Bible gives us several such pictures of angels worshiping God. We have already seen the seraphim proclaiming God to be holy, holy, holy in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 3. And in Revelation we read, "And I beheld, and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne, and the beasts and the elders. And the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000, and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. Revelation chapter 5 verses 11 through 12. The angels provide a good pattern for us to follow. How often do we rush off to serve God or others, perhaps in some good and necessary way, and neglect to first worship God and adore Him? Of course, we should give God and others our every effort in service. But before that, we need to spend time in His presence, getting our hearts tuned up.